better do something about that cough, Christina. Don't worry. I'm not crazy. At least, I don't think so.
Hello. Welcome to Last Frame. I am Christina Marquez, and today we have a very special guest with us. I do believe he would like to introduce himself.
Hello, I'm Guy Cihi. I play James Sunderland in Silent Hill 2.
Yes, welcome, Guy. And with us are also my two amazing co-hosts.
Hello, this is Dave Hilborn, and I'm also Chewback from Hell Descent Forums.
And this is Roger, and I used to be in a Hell Descent Forum, but then I quit.
All right, so as most of you know, Silent Hill recently, well, the Silent Hill franchise recently turned 15 years. I do believe it was end of January, February, something like that.
Yeah, 1st of February.
And we thought, you know, what better way to commemorate the series than to highlight arguably one of the most significant and pivotal games in the series, which is Silent Hill 2. And so we figured this would be a fantastic opportunity to interview Mr. Cihi, which is the voice behind James Sunderland, you know? And we have some questions for you, Guy, both from ourselves and the community. So if you would be ready, we can get started right away with the first question.
Sure, go right ahead.
Okay, so first we want to know a little bit more about the guy, pun not intended, behind James Sunderland. Now, in the past, we know you've mentioned doing various types of theater, and we were just curious, what do you think may have inspired you to pursue acting?
Well, when I was young, my my mother played guitar, and my father played piano, and my mother taught my brother and I to sing, and that was where our performing talents began. My brother sings to this day in a band, and I sang in choir at school and also at church, and then I performed in musical productions at my elementary school and high school. Then in the 70s and 80s, when I was still quite young, my father was making some documentary films and also some docudrama type films that were distributed through schools around the United States, and I starred in two of my dad's films, and then I also worked as a cameraman for some of his films.
Wow.
So then after, it was really quite a lot of experiences. I learned about editing back in those days when we would be working on the completing his documentaries. And then it was really quite interesting. My older brother went into film production and I was supposed to. In fact, I was enrolled at film school after high school, but my mother suddenly got this huge inspiration that I should change my major to industrial design, and I really wasn't interested in many things at that time in my life when I was 17. Motorcycles, sex and drugs and rock and roll, that's about all I could get my head around, right? So I was like, okay, Mom, whatever. And so she wrote to the college and changed my major. And I sometimes wonder how my life would have turned out had I gone to film school. Anyway, thankfully I really took to industrial design. I liked it. And in my in my third year of the design program, I was required to take these communications classes. Anybody who's gone to college knows about these classes. They're dreadfully boring and really quite inane. And I asked the dean of my program, what was the purpose of this communications class requirement? And the dean said, Well, being a successful designer requires the ability to communicate in front of groups. And so we require the communications class. And I said, well, Dean, if you want to help the students prepare to speak in front of a group, they really should take acting classes. And he said, well, I'll tell you what, Cihi, you take the acting class as a no-credit elective. And if you still think it's a good idea afterwards, I'll consider it for future years. So I'm like, oh, well. Well, I took him up on it. I did it anyway. And I took the acting classes, and wow, they were fantastic.
Wow.
I had been acting without ever training or learning about it. It's like I had been drawing for years before I went to school and started learning how to render and do the sketching and the three-dimensional work that's necessary to be a designer. And then suddenly I'm able to act with someone coaching me and giving me advice and teaching about the different approaches to acting and creating backstories. And it was fascinating. I loved it. And, you know, how to stand, where to look when you're speaking to an audience, how to move your body when you're speaking in front of people. These are things I remember to this day and make me a much better public speaker. So I remember nothing from the communications classes I was required to take. So I think my real interest in acting started with those classes. I mean, I did it before that, but I didn't understand it as a skill you can develop in that way by making an effort and consciously thinking through things. I mean, there are some people who are so naturally talented, I guess they don't really need to worry about that. They're just being on the stage and just being it. And now, well, I mean, I've gone on quite a bit about that. I will tell you one last thing. Now, my son has just gone out in the world, and he's an actor and singer as well.
Yeah, seems to be in the family. Sort of runs in the family with you guys.
Yeah.
Isn't he performing Romeo and Juliet at the moment, Guy?
He did. Yeah. Well, he just wrapped that, but he's now auditioning for pilots for TV shows in New York.
Wow.
And he played with Elizabeth Olsen. He played Romeo and she played Juliet at the Classic Stage Company in Manhattan.
Yeah.
And it was great. I went to see the show, and you know, he went and did a master's degree in acting at NYU Tisch, which is arguably one of the best acting schools in the world. And 3 years there. And I asked him about the experience because I only took two semesters of acting, and he's done 3 years, right? So I was, well, what do they teach you? What are you learning at that level? At that elevated level, right? And he said, basically, you're learning not to act.
Yeah.
You're learning just to be. You've got to,
exactly.
Right? You've got to be the part, not act it.
Yeah.
And you, to do that, you've got to get way past the lines and way past the thinking about the character. You just got to be. So really, you're learning how to be yourself in that part on the stage or in front of the camera. So that was really interesting to learn that from him. And I'm still learning about acting. I learned even today. I posted a link to some video that a fan made by re-editing some material I had done several years back.
Yep.
And people are commenting on it, and I'm learning from their comments even now about how that worked out. And it's interesting. Yeah, so I really like it. I mean, I wish I could do more of it. It would be fun.
was that the thing that I posted on yesterday, Guy, that I said had a very Poe vibe to it?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
Which it does have.
I recorded that like 3 years ago, I think.
Yeah, I remember when you first put it up.
And a fan sent it to me, and it was kind of hauntingly interesting. And his first language is not English, so it has a very romanticized version of English translation, right? And I recorded it, and I put some, and I thought, well, I think that was actually the first thing I ever recorded since fans started contacting me, and it was the first dramatic reading I'd done in years. So I wanted to put some images to it, so I was just, oh, okay, and I'll go fart around with Movie Maker, and I edited that video and threw it up there, and it's kind of sat there all this time. Now, I think his name is Curtis Ryan. He he found it and he re-edited it to Silent Hill 2 images. And I don't know if you've seen it yet, but it really struck me very deeply with how, oh my goodness, this thing was written for Silent Hill 2. Oh, what a dummy I am, right? I mean, of course, a fan sends me this thing. And I suppose he thought I would get it, but I didn't get it at first. And now I asked Curtis if he knew that from the first time he heard it. Did he figure that out the first time? And he said, no, it was only when I started editing it that I saw how the images were just going together with it. And I,
wow.
So I don't know. Maybe it was. I'm trying to figure that out. I'm trying
That's
to track
a bit of
down.
That's helpful serendipity there, isn't it?
Yeah, really. I'm trying to. Someone else said it that he thought the words might fit well with another game.
That's very
so
helpful.
It may be the universal key, right? This story about being trapped in hell.
Yep.
Yeah.
How about we move on a little bit? Now, this next question sort of ties into what you've been talking about now, you know, because it addresses certain past projects and things you've done in the past. But maybe, you know, let's... Roger, do you want to go ahead and ask the question anyway?
Yeah, well, we heard that you worked on some projects before. But what other significant projects have you worked on? Are you working on anything at present?
Well, I am, but I have a game software. I like to think of it as a game software business now. It started out as an education software company, but I see that the future is in, they're called serious games. This is a way of commuting knowledge in a very painless and fast way. So I have certain expertise. My company has some patents on the process of refining knowledge so that it can be quickly assimilated. This dates back, you know, I've got a long history in this education area, and I have been keenly aware of mankind losing out in the race to manipulate knowledge, and I don't like that. So I know where humans have special talents that cannot be, at least at this point in time, cannot be duplicated or bested by machines. And I like working in that area. I like keeping... You ever see that movie Terminator?
Yep.
I'm the anti-Terminator. Yeah. I'm one of the people fighting against the machines. I'm a, I wouldn't call myself a neo-Luddite, but I prefer
that to... That made you John Connor.
No, I won't claim that. But I'd be one of the people on his team.
Hurrah.
So I'm working on serious games to help people acquire knowledge about things they need to know about or want to know about.
I don't actually think there's a better combination. If you can be entertained and also educate yourself at the same
draw
time.
Draw knowledge from it, yeah,
it's an
exactly.
incredibly noble pursuit, I think.
Yeah. Thank you. The trick is to not be thinking about learning while you're doing it. Then otherwise it becomes work. So you've got, now, there are some very popular games out there like Candy Crush,
mm-hmm.
which your brain is working, but there's nothing left over after you've played it. Nothing of no value retained.
Yeah.
So, like fast food for the brain.
Yeah. So if you can retain something useful after having played, that's what I want to do.
Wow.
Amazing. Yeah. And I think that is needed in the gaming industry nowadays, you know, with how gaming is more focused on just pure entertainment and violence, you know, and blood. There needs to be something else, some deeper value to it. So,
well,
you know,
yeah, that would be nice. Like if they have, but that's over there, right? Those are people making real games like Silent Hill 2 and Team Silent people. And I'm not in that genre. I'm not in that, that level. Those guys are way beyond what I do. I'm talking about taking the kind of really boring education software that's being rammed down students' throats or their iPads and trying to make something that's bright, that's fun to use, and the academic community respects. So it comes from a basis in the academic community that's defensible, but and yet at the same time the students like it. And then if I get my way, it's going to be free. Mm-hmm. So,
is out of curiosity, is this the Lexica project or whatever it's called?
That's right.
Lexica.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Wow. That's about everything. I'm working on that, and I've got a. I don't know how much you guys know about what I do. I mean, sometimes fans, they don't know very much about me, so...
We're reasonably confident.
Reasonably knowledgeable, yeah.
Okay. All right. I've got a college that I'm in the process of transacting. I'm going to be selling it. So wow. I've been involved in it for about 7 years now. In all, and it's grown up quite a bit. I think it started with about when we acquired it, my group, about just under 4,000 students, and now it's just over 12,000 students. So it's really expanded over that period of time, and we've gone about as far as we can go with it. It's time to move on because of the scale that it's reached. We need to put it in the hands of a bigger partner who can take full advantage of what it offers. But yeah. I've been very proud of that as well because it deals in natural medicine and
wow.
Training.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, training practitioners for the future in all forms of nutritional medicine and naturopathy, homeopathy, acupuncture, massage therapies, and so forth. All the things that. You know, natural, the way medicine was before petrochemicals were used. So that's another project I've been involved in that's been a big part of my life for the last 7 years.
That is fantastic.
And again, that's an incredibly sort of philanthropist, or maybe that's not the right expression I'm looking for, but it's incredibly...
Well, I hope not, Dave. I'm planning to make some money off of it.
He's honest.
Oh, you evil businessman.
Yeah, I'm an evil. See, that's the difference. You can choose what kind of project you want.
There's the ugly face of corporate rearing its ugly head. Very good. shall we continue, guys?
Yeah. Do you feel satisfied with the answer, Guy? Or is there anything you'd like to add?
On projects I'm working on? I'm happy with that. I'm working on a game that has never mind. I won't tip my hand on the game, so you can just wait for this.
All right. Okay, so the next question I guess gets more back into Silent Hill 2 territory. You know, sure. I guess it was inevitable, you know, we have to start talking about it eventually. But
No, please. That's what it's about. That's what fans want to hear about.
Bearing in mind that you had very little knowledge about the actual, you know, story and the ending of Silent Hill 2 and all that. What kind of motivation did you receive from Team Silent to prepare you for each scene, or as the general role, you know, for James Sunderland?
That's a deep one.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's deep because it was 15 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, I really want to be fresh about this, so I want to recall a memory of it, not just repeat what I've said before to other people. Mm-hmm. I have said in the past that they did not give me much detail they didn't elaborate on what the different endings would be. They certainly never disclosed anything about the UFO ending or even the dog ending, which I recorded the lines for, they didn't describe it. The only endings that I was vaguely aware of were, you know, and I didn't have any idea about the endings. Even after we recorded it, for me, they could have recorded the scenes and put them in a different order for all I knew that how it was going to come out. So about my motivation to take each particular scene, it was minimal. I think it goes back to the audition where they decided that I was like James, and so they just wanted me to keep doing more of that, which was be that kind of
human.
They wanted maybe a normal guy it sort was of very, trapped
yeah,
in this
they, exactly.
hell.
They didn't want me to overplay it at all. They wanted me to... Well, I mean, you see the performance, and that's how they liked it. So when I did it that way, I think when I listened to it, it seems I thought I was putting more out than even I see in it. So I imagine other people see it as even more cool or. What's the right word I'm looking for? It's like hidden. There's not a lot showing there when I listen to it. So I think it might even appear more so to others. When I look in the mirror at myself, or when someone takes a picture of me, I'm always surprised because I thought I was smiling when I did that. And when I see the photo, I look at my face and I don't see a smile on there. It looks like I'm just neutral. So yeah. I think when I'm not smiling, my face is kind of taciturn. And when I'm smiling, it's neutral. And if I really do a big smile, then it looks like
maybe it looks like a smile.
A normal smile to other people. And I saw the other day somebody posted, I have bitch face. It's a genetic problem that when I'm not smiling really big, my face looks really bitchy. And I thought, yeah, I got that. Yeah. So somebody posted that, and I said, you're cursed for bitch face, or bastard face in my case. I've got this. So I think they liked that for the part, and I had figured out he was living in a nightmare, certainly a hellish world that he. When you go through and you watch the game and all the stuff he sees, he never really gets bent out of shape about it, does he? He never really starts freaking out or losing it or getting extremely emotional. He just rolls from one thing to the other. The one, and I've said this before, but the one bit of advice that stood out in my mind, it may have been Ito. I'm a little confused now between Sato and Ito. I keep thinking it was Sato, but it may well have been Ito who said to me, your character doesn't really show a lot of emotion. It's the other characters that define you. He said, if you've ever seen a Clint Eastwood movie, it's kind of like he doesn't act a lot. It's all these people around him are defining what he does. I don't know if that's a true analogy or not, but it stuck with me. So I kept that in my mind.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, I've always seen James as like probably the most human and realistic video game character I've ever seen.
Dave, that's because there are so many similarities. I mean, I didn't kill my ex-wife, but she certainly tried to kill me, so I know what the feeling was like. Yeah, it was a hard one. So, yeah, I
just tap into people.
Don't laugh, it's serious. Yeah. Don't laugh, it's serious.
It's good to laugh at it because otherwise I'd be crying about it. And it was very tough back then, but I had just been out of that marriage for only only a couple of years, really. It was hard. It took me almost 5 years to go from separated to divorced because it had to be done so gradually and carefully. So my ex-wife is was at that time quite famous in Japan, and she was, difficult to say the least when she went into a certain kind of frame of mind. And for me, it took some finesse to have her leave me standing or leave my company standing. I think she on several occasions threatened to go on television and tell everybody that, horrible things about me. And that would have basically, some actress in your country goes on television and starts ratting out her husband and saying terrible things about him. You might listen to what she's saying. And that scared me.
I mean, think about rumors if you repeat that a lot, people will start believing it.
Yeah, so that at that time, I had my children, my company, and my wife, and here I was losing my wife, and I was having my company threatened, and also having my children threatened because I might lose them through that process. So it was It was pretty low for me. And then I survived it, but like I say, it took 5 years to get to the point where we had an amicable divorce because I just waited until she was ready to move on mentally, and then she finally got to that point, and it was easier to separate on that basis. But those were hard years. So when the game came along, it's like, toughing it out, a difficult emotional situation, and yeah, bottling it all up inside you, but having that pent up rage was all very easy for me. I'm not saying, I don't know if they saw it or not. They said, well, okay, react to the news that your wife has died. And I just sat down and started crying in front of them and because that was all so close. It was all that pain and sadness was so close. So there you go.
That's an amazing
one. Wow, it's honestly, that is a very touching story, with how your life seems to have sort of coincided with what you would have to do for this role. Just not in the same way, obviously, but sort of on, some maybe parallel ways. And it must have,
Well, there you go. See, I had that in me. I don't usually, I'm a basically a happy person, a happy-go-lucky. And to be a happy-go-lucky person requires a great talent. It requires the talent to forget bad things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And move forward and be in the moment.
Don't hold a grudge.
Yeah, exactly.
It's the hardest part.
So I'm able to do that. It was a little hard digging into that while we were recording to go back and call up. And so I've said, after a day after being on the set is when we were in some heavy scenes, and I had to, especially the death scenes when Mary's dying, I would be pretty unsociable for maybe another day after that.
Unsurprisingly
so. Yeah.
Imagine it takes a toll on you.
It did back then.
Yeah.
Shall we stick with the theme of the set for a second?
Sure.
And we can move on to maybe the next question, which is a little bit more upbeat. What was the atmosphere like on set? I mean, was there, obviously when you're in a very sort of intense situation, there has to be moments of humour to sort of break things up, to sort of, break the ice. Can you recall anything, that's sort of really funny that happened during the recording sessions that sort of, cracked you up and sort of, lightened the mood for a bit?
Well, I don't really remember much of anything about the recording sessions in the sound studio.
Right.
And because that was really such a small part of it. We were in the sound studio, I guess, a total of 3 days for me. And maybe Dave was in there for a day. And Donna was probably in there for a day, maybe two. I know Monica was in there for at least 2 days, possibly a third. And our paths crossed only one day that I recall, where Monica and I were in the studio together. So when you think about, what you think about the work we did, it's nothing like I'd think about it. It's all stage work for me. We were on the stage, and that's where the work was done, and all the recordings were done there.
Yeah. With the mo-capping, mm-hmm.
Well,
yeah.
I mean, we were wired, and they were filming it, too, so for me, it was like a filmmaking project, although we were wearing these strange costumes. So for me, I look at it that way. Now, in terms of what was the mood on the set like, on those sets, because for the mood to be anything but, okay, this is a good question. I'm glad you asked now. I'm going to think more carefully about this. On the days when it was everyone together, where we were going to shoot two or three scenes, usually cut scenes where multiple characters interact, those were fairly stressful days. They were fun, but Donna is kind of like the character she plays. She's kind of difficult in some ways sometimes. I mean, she's a nice woman, extremely talented, but she's She, I think maybe she views herself as in a class above where I was in terms of skill or credits, because I hadn't been a professional actor in her scene. So for as far as she was concerned, I had just come in off the street. And I think she didn't really give me enough credit for the work I had done, because I hadn't been participating in the Tokyo acting scene with her, or voice recording scene. And so that's okay. I mean, I didn't mind that part, but Monica, I don't know, maybe I'm just a difficult person. It was pretty stressful on the days when we were all together there. Dave and I, no problem. I mean, we only had the one scene together in the meat locker where we played together, and and that went really well. The rest of the time we were recording on our own. So, I do remember a stressful day on the set with Monica. I just think Monica and I were kind of like, you know, that love-hate kind of wheel that goes around. There's like a love becomes so close to hate becomes goes back around, where you're just like in the friend zone, and then you're back around towards you could be lovers, or you might be, you might hate each other. Well, we were both you know, already spoken for, we were both in relationships, so it wasn't any opportunity for us to explore whether we might actually get along. But there were sparks when we were together, so we were a sparky type couple. And that, I think that really worked for us. I don't, I'm very pleased.
May have come across in, you know,
yeah, well,
the
there was
chemistry
a lot
between
of,
James and Mary or there Maria. Were,
and Maria, there was a lot of energy between us. And most importantly, since she had studied acting and I had studied acting, and we had never really done anything with it because we were both in business, we actually put more into it than most people ever would. Most professional actors would have looked at it and measured the number of hours before they got to go to their next job and how much they're paying me. We both looked at this as like, this may be the one big shot I have to do something.
Yes.
And there was no holding back. And when she and I were working together, we were really pushing each other, kind of like that movie Rush, where the two drivers are antagonistic toward each other, but they raise each other's game.
Yep.
It was it was intense, and I really look back on it, and it was tense, but it was very, very satisfying, especially when we knew we had done a good job. Now, when that was on the stage, we took that over when we went into the recording booth. We're alone, I was able to. I'm sure she did too, because her performance is fabulous in that game. So you were able to just replay what you did on the stage with each other, or to bring up that mood. Gosh, she was great at that. So the mood was, generally speaking, tense, actually, a little bit frustrating. And then once the cut scenes that involved the other players were gone, or if it was just Dave and I and the team, it got very playful. And towards the end, see, because I did about 3 months of mocap with them. Dave was in there for a couple of weeks, Donna a slightly less, and Monica slightly more, maybe about a month in total. So I mean, I'm more possibly 2 months. I really don't know how much mocap they did with Monica, but I know I was there 3 months. And I remember the last sessions, because I was doing the falls, and I said, please put all the falls to the end, right, in case I hurt myself. And so all the stupid stuff you don't think about, because you're just playing, you know. I mean, the people don't think that those were really people falling when the characters in the game fall down. They really were.
This is a bit of myth.
Okay, now you've got to get in a rowboat and row the boat. And none of these people had ever rowed a boat before. Or you've got to, all right, pick up the chainsaw and start the chainsaw. And they'd made a little cardboard thing I was supposed to pick up. And none of them had ever used a chainsaw. They might not have even seen one. And so here was I used to design chainsaws when I was working in not that long ago in industrial design. So I'm okay. Well, you got to do it like this, right? And they're like, oh, great. So we had a great time. And okay, keep running. Yes, keep running. And so yeah, it got very playful on the set because they were cheerful and I was cheerful when there wasn't like a pissing contest going on the stage. So
talking about funny, that, let's just ask something. Whose idea was that animation with a chainsaw? You know, if you just don't move James, and after a while he just gets a chainsaw and starts screaming.
His primal scream?
Yeah. Was your idea? Was it your idea?
Oh no. That they said they wanted me to scream. They told me they wanted me to scream. I'm gonna guess it was either Ito or it could have been Sato.
Man, that scared the shit out of me.
Is that what happens? It suddenly, yeah, I'm bad.
Yeah, I was like having a coffee, and I was okay. I'm gonna just stop for a while to sip my coffee. And then he just, and then there's coffee all over my living room.
Well, that's a very, I'm sorry about that. You know, it's a funny story about the scream is I was at a convention in Portland years ago, and a guy came up to me and he was hovering around the outside. I was talking to several other people, and he was hovering and kind of looking at me, and I had my name tag on, and I think he was looking at my name tag, and then finally he got a clearing. He came in. Are you Guy Cihi? I said yes. Are you the Guy Cihi? Well, I am the Guy Cihi. Do the chainsaw thing. I'm like, what are you talking about? I had no idea what he was talking about. I'd never seen the game. I'd never seen the chainsaw scene. I had no idea they were going to make the scene. They said, do this scream thing. And again, it was one of those cases where they started, okay, well, can you do some screams? And I said, well, hold on. We have all these other scenes to record. Let's do all the screens on the last day. What do you say, fellas? That makes sense to you? Oh, okay. Yeah, that's kind of logical.
It's really, because you're going to need your voice.
Yeah, really burned out the voice doing the screams on that one. So, that's my primal scream. And no, it wasn't my idea. It was their idea. And it is shocking when it happens the first time. And
yeah, because you're just not expecting that.
But that's James, right? There's all that pent-up frustration in there. And it only happens with the chainsaw, correct? So you've already played the game and beaten it or gotten to the end once, because you cannot get the chainsaw until you played it once. So then in the second and third playthroughs, they start getting playful. Like you can't get the dog ending, I think, in the first playthrough either. You've got to have beaten it once. And it was definitely Sato who explained to me about Easter eggs and convinced me to record certain things that I was against recording. That just to show you how out of place I was. Here's me like imagining my great final. I'm finally being recognized for my theatrical skills, and now they want me to denigrate this incredible performance I've just laid down with these stupid scenes and a dog. After that incredibly moving emotional experience of. That is Silent Hill 2. And he said, well, you know, okay, Guy, but he didn't say come down off your high horse and get real. He might have said that. He said, look, you know, it's a game, and when their kids are playing it, we put these things in it, we hide these things and call Easter eggs. So if you know, please just do it for me, okay? Just do it for me. Okay, if you ask that way, I'll do it. I think about how silly I was at the time, you know, how ignorant I was of the way things, of the way the game industry works. I mean, the fact that he even bothered to talk nicely to me about it is amazing. He should have just said, just do it, stupid.
Do it.
You're just the actor, man. What are you talking about? Just do it.
Yeah, man.
Right.
No wonder they haven't hired me again.
No return of James Sunderland.
doesn't play with others or chainsaws.
Are you satisfied with that answer? because the next question sort of ties in with what you were talking about before with your co-actors. Now, in some ways, it's sort of evident that you seem to have made some good, you know, lifelong friends during the recording of Silent Hill 2. David Schaufele, for instance, you seem to be really close with. Was there any, would you say, pivotal moments between the two of you on set that may have caused this friendship or anything else, really? I mean, you were talking about that one scene. Maybe we can get some more insight.
Oh, gosh. You know, I wish I could say that there was something in particular, but I'll say that he was the only other man, foreign man there. So, I mean, unless I'm missing somebody, I hate to think that I would be missing a bro or something, or another guy who was there. There was me and a bunch of women and him, and then all the Japanese people who they're like, they have their own culture and so forth, and they were in their own world, so they would often be chatting as if we didn't exist, right? Then we would be talking as if they didn't exist. So we were in our own spheres. So it was Dave and I there. Mm-hmm. Let's see. I'm not really sure how we connected after it was done, or how it blossomed into a friendship. But you know, I take it, at least Dave, I don't know Roger, we've not met, but you guys are getting, you're beyond your, maybe beyond your 20s now, and
I'm 24.
Yeah,
I'm 37.
Okay, so you're.
Six for me.
Yeah, you're grown-up men and still a young woman, but especially for the men, as you get older, it's harder to make new friends.
Yep,
and one of the good pieces of advice that men in their 20s and even in their teens should take to heart is that keep your friends close as you get older, because they're very important. And I was lucky to be, because I live in Japan and my friends are pretty much all back in the U.S. from my youth. And I was able to meet Dave, and he's married. He's got 3 children. I'm married. I have 4 children. We like to ride motorcycles. We work. We have pretty much our own businesses. So we have flexible schedules. We're free, independent thinkers. I have a lot in common. And so it's been really nice that we didn't immediately become friends. It grew slowly over time. Yeah, it really took a long time. But now he's, I would say, one of my best friends.
That's amazing.
Truly amazing.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, there's a gift that keeps on giving from Silent Hill 2. And as much as I respect the Team Silent people, I've never heard from one of them since. I shouldn't say that. I had a brief conversation with Sato over the internet once, but not really, haven't heard from any of the others.
I mean, it's very...
Monica's, you know, she lives in L.A., and it was great to see her again when Dave and I went over there. But I have, you know, just the distance involved makes it difficult.
Yeah.
Understandable.
So that's how I met Dave, and we should probably go out riding again. We used to ride the bikes outside Tokyo, our motorcycles, but I haven't.
When you see him again, send him a hug, because he's awesome.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, he really is awesome, and
he is awesome.
Yeah.
You know,
I got in trouble once because of one of his lines.
Which one?
I was drunk, so I was in a pub, and there was this copper, this police guy.
Yep.
And I just look at him, put finger in my head, and say, killing a person is no big deal.
Oh, no.
He just put a gun to the head. Wow. Oh, said, yeah. What did you say? Silent Hill 2, you play video games, I'm sorry, I'm sober, like, instantly, like, oh, I'm sober, yes.
Yeah, that'll sober
you. Better go home now.
Certainly, or two actually sobers you up as well. Yeah. Good cure, yeah. Good cure for a hangover. Yeah.
Okay, so are we moving on?
Sure.
Yep. Yeah.
I think sure one, Roger.
Yeah.
So, well, I don't. You're probably a very busy guy, and you don't play games like a PlayStation 3 games or something like that, right, Guy?
No, I don't.
Yeah. So, sorry. Well, no, because we got this really good games coming back with this theme of emotions and stuff, like a Walking Dead game and The Last of Us. They've been praised mostly because of the emotional and human aspects of the narrative. You know, they deal with issues like the death of a loved one and physical and psychological abuse. And the question is, do you think it's kind of a direct influence from Silent Hill 2? Because I can't remember at the time any game touching that kind of subject. So it was a kind of the first one?
Yeah, I do believe it was. Silent Hill 2 was honestly one of the first games that I can remember that really touched upon something that heavy.
Mm. I'm sure it's an influence, but I'm not sure if it's a purposeful in that way. I believe that what's happened is the audiences are growing up, number one, and number two, the game industry is disintegrating towards niche producers and smaller production companies. And those two things happening at the same time have allowed, or actually required, the makers to seek something real, to seek to provide a more real experience. And ultimately, the only thing that matters are the relationships between people, not none of the technology and all that stuff. So even the shoot 'em up games are going to be increasingly dealing with the relationships between the characters. So as you build games that are designed to explore the relationships between characters, you're necessarily going to have to touch on these heavier hidden lifelong scar type.
Because it's like Silent Hill game is the game that people are not ashamed to say, oh, I cried when I played that game.
Yeah.
And sorry to interrupt you. And also, you got like teenagers when they first play the game. They have no children. They're not married, so they kind of experience this loss and sadness that they didn't know about it at the time. So I think that was one of the most rich games that someone can play. Because it wasn't just about killing monsters in a foggy town.
Mm.
And I think that people that worked up doing the Walking Dead game and The Last of Us, they play that and they kind of try to emulate, you know, going forward with this thing of let's bring up an adult experience, let's touch some serious subjects.
Yeah, very much so, Roger. I agree with you. Yeah.
I'm sure that we're going to see more games like that because they can be done. Well, there's a couple of reasons, but like I said, the demographics, there's an aging audience of players are looking for a richer experience, something that touches their emotions deeply. And then you're going to be wanting to produce games for less money because there's more risk and more diversity in the types of platforms and interests that are out there. Mm-hmm. So it's harder to concentrate money on one subject. You see even major game companies closing now to focus on. Now, I keep an eye on the game industry and where the money's moving and what people are thinking as a business and not as a player. And I'm It wouldn't surprise me that you'll see more of these psychological dramas as opposed to technological dramas.
That could be good for us.
And I think that also maybe ties in a little bit with the fact that I think the gap between the gaming and the movie industry is closing in. And I think, you know, to touch upon something as basic and, well, not as basic, but as fundamental as human emotion, I think, you know, that's a direct effect of that, simply that the gap is closing. Mm.
You know, what surprised me the most and was that there were fans who were pretty angry at James. And some of that anger, you know, came through pretty clearly. That surprised me. So, and it still surprises me because of, you know, where my mind was at, my head was at in playing in the game. So, yeah, it was when I understood why they were angry. I mean, are we dealing with spoilers here? I guess we, at this point in time, 15 years later.
I think at this point it's safe to say that, you know, you can go ahead. It's clear.
Yeah, you can go ahead.
Daddy killed
everybody. Everybody knows that you're the dog.
Yes.
the dog ending. The dog is you.
That's the reality.
Basically, yeah. Basically, they're facing daddy killing mommy, and that's really heavy.
It is. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, no wonder they were angry, and some of them didn't even want to talk about it. You know, it's very. Mm. It's no way that it could have been a euthanasia scenario. It has to be he murdered her, and now we want justice, right? Where's the prison?
Well, again,
why hasn't he been captured yet? That kind of a thing, and I'm like,
again,
now I'm looking over my shoulder.
Guy, your answer there is a perfect segue into the next question.
If you're
happy to move on.
Sure.
In past interviews, you've mentioned like the leave ending as being the one that would be the most appropriate and sensible for James as his character stands. What do you think James would have done after he left Silent Hill with Laura? You know, do you think he would have turned himself into the police as sort of a crisis of conscience? Would he have adopted Laura, or would he have maybe put her into an orphanage? Give us a brief sort of moral analysis of where you see the guy going from there, you know, James going from there.
Okay. Yeah. Just to clarify, I said, and I still say, that I like the leave ending for me.
Yep.
That's the way I would want it to end. Mm-hmm. And I've since figured out from the evidence that Team Silent's core ending, I won't call it canon, we'll just call it the one they put the most effort into.
Would be is not
role. That's not me, because I will be the last man standing.
Yeah,
so that's just me, and I don't know if that I'm sure at some very deep level it connects to my words and how they sound to you when you talk to me, and or when you listen to what I say, is that I will be the last person standing.
Yeah.
I won't. So committing suicide would not have worked out. I would resolve my debt in another way.
Yep.
And the other way I would resolve it in this case is easy. It's the leave ending. And that is me adopting Laura, not remarrying, just taking care of her, living a private life, and being extremely protective of her, almost to the point of being troublesome, right? Where she's growing up. And it's time to step back and recognize that she's a young woman and she's got to socialize, otherwise her life will not be happy, and, you know, understanding that as well, and, you know, not being a pain in the ass as she starts to date, just making sure that her people who want to take her out on a date know that she's not alone and that they're at risk if they mess with her. So that I'd be that kind of dad for her. And someone wrote a scenario.
They'd have an angry James with a chainsaw after them.
yeah, they would. Someone wrote a scenario and suggested that Laura gets a letter from Silent Hill, and it's from Mary, and she takes off because she knows if she shows it to James, he'll stop her from going. But she leaves, and she leaves a letter for James as a possible sequel. And I thought that sounded like a great setup for a sequel.
Uh-oh.
And James gets to go back and play the hero in the second round instead of the evil guy who's twisted and dark and sad in the first one.
I could redeem myself of redemption. There.
Yes, exactly. You know I liked that one, Dave.
That's a classic. Are you satisfied? I'm happy with that. I'm happy to move on.
Would you have turned yourself into the police, though? That's the question.
No. Before the police, for what? Have you ever looked at my page? My profile page? State? What basically what you're asking me, would I turn myself into the state?
To the state? No. Probably
to
not.
The state.
Probably not.
I'm an anarchist.
Okay.
I don't in the state.
Okay.
I'm an anti-statist. No.
Okay.
It was bad enough. I have enough to deal with myself if I'm James. That's it, you know.
One less burden you don't need.
Need to give yourself a break.
Yeah.
Shall we carry on then? We're about to wrap this up, actually. We just have one more thing to ask. Now, we know that in some past interviews, there has been mention of a potential Let's Play where you sort of take part and watch and commentate over Silent Hill 2 gameplay. Maybe not through the entire game, but maybe certain key scenes, you know. And now, if this was for, I don't know, a good cause or something, charity, would you maybe consider participating? You know, something like this?
I would like to do that. It would be fun. But I've watched a couple of Let's Plays. And, in fact, you know who likes Let's Plays? It's my 11-year-old daughter. She watches them all the time now, and it always surprises me, but she knows a lot about the latest games that are out because she watches the Let's Plays. We don't have the game system here, so we have a Wii. She gets to play Mario Kart.
different league.
Yeah, so
Pyramid Head Edition.
So she's watching these Let's Plays, and she said, "Dad, you gotta see this one and watch it." And my impression is the Let's Plays are pretty light-hearted fare. There's lots of banter and chat and so forth. And I'm not sure that
it's supposed to be like a more fun thing, you know?
Yeah. So I'd have to, I don't know. I'd have to work myself up for that. I'm not sure that I'm ready to do a Let's Play of Silent Hill 2. Maybe I could do a Let's Play of another game. But I would do it. Technically, making those things, I like to do a good job. And I'm sitting down and just playing the game and talking as I go through. I got close to that with one of the things I did. I played the what do you call that? The arcade game.
Oh, yeah, that's
Silent Hill. I remember that.
Remember?
I remember that.
Yeah, okay.
That was funny.
And then I made a video of that. And that
Die Pyramid Before You Die or something.
Yeah, that was
Triangle Boy. I remember that.
But I don't know if I could keep that up for 30 minutes or something. So I think what I'd rather do is a what do they call that? It's you get the deluxe version of the video program, like the DVD, the direct, what do you call it? The special edition.
Yeah.
And on one of the tracks, they have either one of the actors or the director is giving commentary.
Director commentary.
There you go. So I wasn't the director, but I would do the actor's commentary on maybe the cutscenes. So I think I might do that. Plus, making the video and ripping as you're playing the game and so forth. I don't have the game console. I have some games, but I don't have the console and I don't have the equipment to record it. So that's a lot of work. Now, if somebody out there listening today wants to put together a video for me to do this to record the audio for, I'd be happy to do that. But there's a lot of work that goes into editing together a decent program, and I don't want it to run more than, say, 10 minutes at the most. So it would have to be a selection of scenes, and then I'd get Dave to come in, and we could talk through some fun stuff. Then it would be more entertaining. Maybe we could get Monica to do it long distance.
Wow, that would be amazing.
Yeah.
That would be amazing, yes. It would be very interesting to hear.
So there you go. A little long-winded answer. I would do it, but I'm not interested in doing a traditional Let's Play. I would be more interested in doing like a
conference. If someone provided the gameplay and provided everything else, you know, you just stand for the audio. That would be something you would
have. Well, let me ask you guys some questions.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, you've come to me and you've asked me to talk about my experiences, but you know more about it as players than I do.
Mm-hmm.
So what part of the game brings you to tears or brought you to tears in the first time when you played it? What was it?
Oh, God. If you guys don't mind.
The ladies first.
For me, it was just, even thinking about it now, almost brought me to tears. Thinking about when he says goodbye to Mary, you know, or however the ending is, and just that final letter that just absolutely... Yeah, that just brought me to tears. It was a very powerful, emotional moment for me.
Mary's letter, yeah.
Yeah, Mary's letter, and just that final scene, you know, where he's sitting next to her and she's laying down. I was also very shocked the first time I figured out what had actually happened. You know, some things dawned on me while I was playing, but never anything like that. So it was just fantastic. The whole game was just one of those things that I will never, ever forget. And I want to personally thank you, Guy, for making that happen by playing James.
Mm, thank you. What about you guys?
Roger?
Dave?
You're deferring to me as usual.
Stop being so humble.
I would actually say that it's the long hallway scene just before... just before the end, where James is obviously playing over something in his head from Mary, where she's saying, you know, I bought you some flowers, and she's saying, I don't want any flowers. I found that to be very moving.
Yeah, I agree.
There was something I deliberately took my time walking up that hallway so I could hear the entire conversation. It always gets to me every time. It's just amazing, I think.
You can just see the duality of their relationship, you know.
And also,
she was scared on one hand, and she
also
was angry.
I just think the voice acting there between, you know, the two is absolutely phenomenal.
Mm.
Roger.
We've stolen Sunday now.
When I first played the game, I had a friend of mine, really good friend of mine, that committed suicide. Like 2 months ago, and I kind of was still in shock because I couldn't cry, and I was just okay, dead, went to his funeral, so I got that inside me. And when I play the game and we get to the part of the letter, and Mary's reading the letter, and she sounds tired. Not angry, like just sad and tired, and just I had enough of this. So I just had to, I went out for a cigarette and I just start crying, like couldn't stop because it was bringing up all the thing that happened with my friend. So that still gets me every time because it takes me back to when that happened.
So, wow.
That's it.
Yeah, I've heard from some other people that there were events in their life that it allowed them to release bottled up feelings through. And it was that way for me too, as you guys now know.
Yep.
So it was, it's pretty intense. It'll be, so let's see. Though all of those, all those experiences are part of my experience too, losing someone to suicide and way before their time, and then that scene in the long hallway, which for me is the most important, most revealing scene for me in the production. And then of course the bedside scenes with Mary are maybe the most difficult emotionally. So you've hit three very significant parts. Well, let's see, do I have another question about it then? That was pretty heavy. Let's go for something lighter. Which were the most entertaining or light or
that is easy.
Interesting part of the game? I mean, from an entertainment from a humorous perspective. Let's start with Roger this time. We'll save you for last, Christina. Roger.
Yeah.
Most entertaining and humorous.
I love Eddie. I think Eddie's so funny. And I always like the first time we met him in an apartment, and he's throwing up. And I was keep getting back to see what he would say next. And there's a part, I think if you do that for the fourth time, he says, "You're not supposed to go somewhere else." And I say, okay, I'll keep playing then. That's one of my favorite moments. Just getting back and he's throwing up, and then when all the dialogue's options and he says something like, you're supposed to go somewhere else, go.
Yeah, no, that's funny. I forgot about all of those second takes, right? And I didn't have such a big, I think my lines in most of those cases were like, oh yeah, right. But those guys got to say some cool stuff, and then I forgot we took it. And then one time I was watching a cutscene someone had put up, and that suddenly came on. It was where he goes back and then hears that, and I'm thinking, that's really strange. Oh yeah, it's a game. They would have to have done that in case the player went back. And we didn't think of it that way when we were recording. We thought of it more like a movie. So
I think Angela does the same thing as well if you come back.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, she does. Yeah. Oh, is it just those two that do that? No one else?
Mary's just when she's in the hospital, she's just in the bed, so I think doesn't say anything.
I see.
She's just saying that it's comfy.
Go away. Let me sleep.
Dave, what's your funniest memory?
It's probably unintentionally funny, but that sort of describes my weird sense of humor that I've got anyway. And that's after that incredibly heavy scene with Angela and James where he confronts the abstract Eddie. I've always found it really sort of funny that she sort of picks the TV up and sort of throws it on him.
So I think someone wrote a paper on that at college, the whole dissertation on the throwing of the television and the significance of that.
Wow.
you are aware that a lot of people write their papers at university on this game.
Yeah, you know? I have a friend that did on the sexuality theme of Pyramid Head and everything.
There's probably some TV evangelist on the TV at the time, wasn't it?
I had a fan write to me very earnestly just recently and say, "I've finally cracked it. James Sunderland is a Freemason." Is it? And you're a Freemason, aren't you? And I was like, wow, it took you long enough to figure that one out. What's a Freemason? Yeah.
Just wait a minute while I Google that. Give me a second.
Have you heard of the Freemasons? Like, let me see. Yeah, actually, I think I have. Christina?
Yeah. Well, some of those scenes were definitely my favorite ones, so this time I had my thunder stolen, but it's only fair enough. I have to say two examples. First of all, that classic line, you know, how can you just sit there eating pizza? This town is full of monsters. I think I got it the other way around, but you get the gist of it. I love that one.
This town is full of pizza, did you just say?
This town is full of monsters.
This town is full of pizza.
Eating monsters.
What?
Yeah, eating monsters.
How can you sit there eating monsters?
And also, for some reason, I don't know why, I'm kind of quirky like that too. That scene where Maria and James are in the hospital and she helps him open the refrigerator, you know, to retrieve the lead ring. And I don't know why, but just whenever she gives him the ring and he's like, thanks. That just
yeah, that's funny.
He just says it so casually.
Thanks, yeah.
I just love that scene. I don't know, it just always
struck me. Yeah, I remember. Yeah, that's cool.
I'm really glad to hear you say that, because that's one of those cringe scenes. When I see that one, I cringe because they, you know, there was no explanation for why I'm saying thanks, like, and I didn't know what the scene was. I'm just saying thanks.
It sounds like she gave you a can of soda.
They probably let me do like one take of it or something, and oh yeah, that's good.
She may as well asked you, you know, to marry her, and you would have been like, you know, thanks for the ring.
Yeah, thanks.
Now some of them. Well, okay, there we go. Some of the lines I listened to today, and I think, oh man, I wish I could do that one again. I wish they had told me what that scene was going to be when I did it. Honestly speaking, in the sound studio, the video that was available for us to see, this is what it's going to look like in the game, as opposed to the live work we did on the stage, we didn't do all the little lines like thanks and the little tiny lines that are part of gameplay on the stage. Because there's no mocap required. They'd already done it for something. I just don't remember that being... I do remember cringing when I hear that line. There's a couple of others, and I'm not going to accept... the only way that that could happen, because we were so serious about this, is that we didn't know that it was going to be used in that way. Or maybe they used... Yeah, anyway, I'll beat that to death. Sorry about that. I'm glad you like it, though, because that other
absolutely
line...
Absolutely hilarious.
This town is full of monsters. How can you sit there eating pizza? That line... I mean, I didn't want to do it as I'm famous, right? Not wanting to do that line. And they're like, no, I mean, this is really going to be funny. I say, well, nobody's going to say this town is full of monsters. No, but the town is full of monsters. Yeah, but we're not going to say the town is full of monsters. We're going to, you know, they're...
It's just a thing that pizza and monsters in the same sentence.
Yeah. It's like, no, okay, well, look, all right, is it possible we can maybe, you know, you can rewrite that line? And then there's a little huddle and they talk it through. And no, we need it like this. Okay. I tried to say it with dignity.
Shakespearean delivery.
Yeah, right.
Thou town, is thou full of thou monsters?
How canst thou sit there and eat, devour pizza?
I don't think I could do it as good again now. It's.
It came out like the first time.
I'd probably start laughing when I was doing it now.
Wow. Well, it obviously turned out for the best anyway, even if it was a little more humorous.
It's a classic line from
it
this.
It is. It's a fan favorite.
Mm. I've seen t-shirts with that.
They're eating. This town is, yeah. All right, well, is there any other favorite lines that you want me to say before I go?
Whatever you want, honestly. We were actually just about to ask you, because we were about to wrap this up. So whatever you want, you have free reign.
Free reign. Give us some iconic James.
Yeah, do some iconic James.
You better do something about that cough, Christina.
Oh no, here comes the James with the pillow. Uh-oh, I better watch myself.
Like that. Eddie! Have you gone nuts?
Oh, God. You better do something about that cough, bro.
Yeah.
Because you don't want me to do something about it. So you better.
Was it Mary? No, you're not.
Oh, amazing. That is very, very, yeah.
Yeah, you could be her twin. Just your hair and clothes are different.
Wow,
I'm nerding so hard now.
I know. I'm sorry, you were sort of incapacitated by Mr. CP's awesomeness here. So,
let's see. Oh, wait. Okay, I gotta list them.
Okay.
Yeah. Don't worry, I'm not crazy. At least, I don't think so. This one's heavy. I was weak. That's why I needed you. Needed someone to punish me for my sins. But that's all over now. I know the truth. Now it's time to end this.
Can you just imagine, like, you've been recording the lines and then everybody sort of like sniggering in the background while you're doing it?
Yeah, right. You guys are helping me, really.
You break the mood.
No, we take you seriously.
You know that.
How do you know about that? Aren't you Maria?
I'm not your Mary.
Did you see the one where I did Maria, where I played Maria, the video?
Yes. Yeah, that was amazing. Yeah.
Yeah. Did you like that?
Wasn't I good?
I wanted to. Some of the fans have said that I was a little, you know, what would you call it? One dimensional. I didn't have enough, you know, depth in my character there. So I thought, maybe they weren't fans. They were my dude. I know who that was. Who said that? So I wanted to, you know, like stretch, flex my acting cred there and take on a really tough role. So I did Maria. All right.
We
should wrap this.
Guy, look, it has been an absolute pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much for being here. I think we're going to try to wrap this up now because we know you're a very busy guy. Again, pun not intended. And, you know, again, we just want to thank you for this fantastic opportunity. And I'm sure the fans out there will enjoy listening to these answers. So just a sincere thank you. And that is a wrap, pretty much.
Cheers, guys. Bye.
Thanks.
Cheers, guys. Goodbye.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. All right. Take care. Cheers. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.